Well, welcome to PANTEX. PANTEX plant is located about 18 miles outside of Amarillo, Texas, here in the Texas Panhandle. We have about 3,200 people that work out at PANTEX, and our primary role is the dismantlement of nuclear weapons. We're also responsible, and historically have been, for the assembly of nuclear weapons. We don't assemble at this time because of the world situation, although we do maintain the capability to come on board with assembling any time. We're responsible for the research and development for high explosive component parts that go into the weapon, and we're also responsible for the evaluation and maintenance of all the nuclear weapons. You know, of the 3,200 people that work out here at PANTEX, a large majority of those people have been working out here for over 20 years, and they're very proud of the role that they've played throughout history. You know, during the Cold War, we were responsible for assembling nuclear weapons, which really was a deterrent to war, and now with the openness and exchange of all the countries with the United States, we are now in the dismantlement phase. And so we are doing our part for continued peace throughout the world. So I think I can speak for all the people that work out here at PANTEX, saying that the job that we do, we're very proud of, because what we do right here outside of Amarillo, Texas, has a global impact, and we have a very positive effect on millions and millions of people all over the world.
Right or wrong,
I'm Tommy.
I'll always love you.
Always.
Till you're gone, I can't forget.
Never, never.
Right or wrong, I'll keep on dreaming.
Uh-huh.
Still I'll wake with that same old regret. All alone,
all alone.
I thought I'd lose you. Still I pray. Right or wrong, I'm still in love with you.
This is the PANTEX plant. They're right in the middle of some of the best farmland in this country. The problem with taking good grain producing country out of cultivation and making a war plant out of it is that it reduces the total amount of grain produced for the livestock in this part of the country.
Well, this is beef country. The whole Texas Panhandle, as well as, say, an area from Amarillo going out in a radius of 250 miles, produces about 70% of all the beef in the country. all the Great Plains, this grazing area here in the Texas Panhandle going on up north through Kansas and Nebraska is the best cattle grazing ranch land in this country and maybe some of the best in the world.
Well, it all begins with the grass. Ranching begins with the grass and ends with the money, I guess. Cowboys on the grass and land and the skill end of the cow works and the ranchers on the strategic and the money end. And speaking of cowboys, it all started down Paulder Canyon. Here we're on a tributary of Paulder Canyon where Colonel Goodnight drove in his first herd of cattle in this part of the country in 1876 and started the ranching business here. Of course, what enabled him to start the ranching business here was Ran Al McKenzie and his troops a little ways over the hump here, gathered up all the Indian ponies out of the Paladur and killed them every one in one big pile, and there's still a big bone pile. If you dig around, you can find over there. So that put the Indians afoot and pretty much helpless and enabled us to move them over into Oklahoma.
To begin with, the Indians were here and they thought it was their land and we had to kill them and scalp them and chase them into Oklahoma. And then the damn Yankees made us free our slaves. That was tough enough. And then we had a depression and a dust bowl. And now we've got this atomic bomb plant here which is just ruining the neighborhood. And it's something we don't need and we don't want. The death factory is named PANTEX, meaning in the panhandle of Texas. But it really is just kind of a work relief program where they manufacture atomic bombs. It's the largest facility in the world that manufactures atomic bombs, and where that now they are disassembling atomic bombs very unsafely and in my mind in the exactly wrong place. And I'm in favor of moving PANTEX to that little center square in the Pentagon. Now that we've moved our military down, we have plenty of room in the Pentagon to take the bombs apart and not have to take them apart here where there's still a few nice people despite having freed our slaves, having had to kill all the Indians, and having had to have the Wittenbergs live in our town.
Well, a lot of people ask, they say, well, what is the battle over PANTEX all about? And really the battle over PANTEX is all about the Cold War and the end of the Cold War. The way the battle started is we had to have nuclear weapons out at PANTEX, and the reason we had to have them is because the danger of having a confrontation with the Russians was a great danger, and people didn't want to risk that. And so for a period of time, there was a need for our country to endanger part of its citizens just to protect the majority of the citizens. The Chamber of Commerce has built this whole battle over jobs, and they initially approved about a $300,000 budget of taxpayer money, people in Amarillo, to try to put on a propaganda campaign to convince the people in Amarillo that PANTEX was all about jobs. It's about bringing jobs to Amarillo, and if you aren't for it, for anything they bring out there, then Amarillo's going to wither up and dry away. And they put posters all over town.
PANTEX today brings in a total area jobs of 11,000, and that's with families, coming into that working at PANTEX. They shop in Amarillo. They do their grocery shopping. They do their clothes shopping at Westgate Mall. That's bringing in all the shopping that they do in Amarillo provides jobs for the city of Amarillo and surrounding areas. So that's how we say that there's 11,000 jobs that PANTEX brings just by their families being here. If PANTEX left. That would leave a void of our population of 27,000. Because you think that those 3,000 jobs would leave, well then their families would leave. The places where they go shop wouldn't have them coming into shop, so they would either have to downsize or possibly leave. So it's very significant. The PANTEX plan is very significant to our economy.
The majority of the people are very much in favor of the continuation of PANTEX. Because of our safety record, because our people are very much involved in the community and they do their part for the community. And while there are some safety concerns and some issues out there, we're dealing with those. And I think most of the people, the majority of the people in Amarillo and the surrounding communities understand that. And they also understand that there's an incredible economic impact with the PANTEX and the continuation of the plant.
One of the really rotten things that the people at PANTEX did was sneak it up on us. We all hated the Nazis and we all hated the Japs for good reason. It was called Pearl Harbor. And so we came out here to make these bombs to kill the Nips and to kill the Nazis. And then they snuck in this thing right after that when we were protecting our arsenal of democracy from communism. They started sneaking in and making the atomic bombs before we knew it. So we really didn't have a chance to debate it in the community until it had happened.
I remember when we were in high school, I seem to recall PANTEX was a kind of quiet and mysterious source of pride in a way, because any time we talk about PANTEX in context of we were number three or number five or in the top 10 of the Russians, missile targets, you know, and we sort of would walk a little taller because we were from a town that the Russians wanted to bomb more than they wanted to bomb Lubbock, you'd say, you know, or even New York City. We thought we were, because they wanted to bomb us more, well, we were probably pretty important.
Many people in Amarillo have always had a hard time dealing with the proximity of PANTEX and dealing it in different ways. I've used my atomic pacifier. It's a piece of atomic art made of old atomic bomb parts. And when I think of PANTEX and it starts to stress me, I will cradle it and stroke it, and it usually tends to soothe me. I've been to 130 some odd foreign countries in my life, and everywhere I go, when I say I'm from Amarillo, someone will come out and say that the most crazed person that they've ever met is from Amarillo, Texas, and it's happened to me hundreds of times, but it's been going on for hundreds of years around this area. The Comanches, who lived in this area for generations, were always considered by most of the other Indians in this region as being the wildest, craziest people in the whole Indian world, and it's been like that for so many years that it was all blamed on the wind. That's what it was all attributed to. We have constant winds here, and it does make you think.
One wonderful thing about Amarillo that I really like is that it's not an unlawful town. It's not a town where people go around being bandits or robbers or things like that, except for the Wittenbergs and the federal employees. It's a lawless town. We're a long way from anything else, and it's a town where we happen to believe that the rules don't apply to us. And I don't believe the rules apply to me. I believe the rules should apply to me if I make the rules for myself, and if I want to obey them, and if I change my mind, then they don't apply any longer. Most of my fellow citizens agree, so we live in a mild state of anarchy, which is the most pleasant way to live in, and no one seems to give a damn because we're way out here in piddly dunk. So we do what we want to in Amarillo. It makes it a nice town to live, providing you're willing to live lawlessly.
We went in at Seymour Johnson Air Force Base, where the F-15Es are, which was really the workhorse of the Persian Gulf War, and were stationed in Italy to go bomb in Bosnia. And I understand Bosnia was bombed yesterday. It was probably the F-15E that did the bombing. In April, they accidentally shot down two helicopters and killed 26 people, and they were specifically designed to be nuclear capable. The F-15D, although nuclear capable, only had one cockpit. They put in an extra cockpit in this fighter to make it a more effective bomber so that it could replace the F-111 in Europe in the theater nuclear role. So we chose this plane because it was particularly responsible for killing hundreds of thousands of people in the past and will continue to do that into the future, and is now the U.S. chief nuclear fighter bomber. And we took household hammers to enflesh Isaiah's prophecy: they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks.
The things the environmentalists are saying are, for the most part, just absolutely nuts.
They'll say anything, and what's strange about it is the media will rarely ever contest them. They're so in love with so many things and just literally despise so much more.
Well, there was tons of perimeter activity when we got there, and it was really quite remarkable. And we walked onto the base from a field and walked up through all, you know, hundreds of people with our household hammers from our homes and hammered on the F-15E in the midst of hundreds of people. They were having war games at the time. It was really just unbelievable. And we hammered for about 45 seconds. Again, we believe it's a symbol of the against technology, against this techno-murdering plane. Hammers are a symbol of construction against this plane, which is responsible for so much destruction.
You know, they want to save the whale and save the snail garter. They want to save all of the trees. They're going to oppose nuclear energy. They're going to oppose nuclear weapons as a force. They're going to oppose oil. They're going to oppose this. They're going to oppose that. They don't want anybody to make any money. They don't even want farmers to even be able to farm their own land. They oppose herbicides and pesticides. It kind of makes you wonder sometimes if they had their way in the future, would we be looking at something like this?
This is the Peace Farm. We're located on 20 acres directly across the highway from PANTEX. We're located almost directly across from where the railroad spur used to bring nuclear weapons trains out of PANTEX and take them to various deployment points all across the United States. And some of our first work was tracking those trains as they left PANTEX and beginning the alert system for activists all along the route that the trains would be following. The decision to buy land in this area came as a result of our need to give permanent presence and permanent witness to the need for nuclear disarmament, an end to the arms race, and an end to the production of nuclear weapons at PANTEX.
You know, it's kind of funny, as I go around the city talking to people about PANTEX, of course they know I'm a city commissioner, but they also know that I work out at PANTEX. So it's kind of funny to see what kind of reactions I get. I get anything from, oh, we're very much in favor of PANTEX and you guys are doing a great job, to how in the world can you guys be out there hurting the environment and hurting the community the way you are. And so I think we all have to know what audience we're talking to and who has what agenda.
The current function of the Peace Farm is monitoring the disassembly of nuclear weapons that's now going on at PANTEX and trying to push the decisions that will be made in the next few years about nuclear weapons and what we do with special nuclear materials that are a part of nuclear weapons into the safest possible decisions for human beings and for the environment, and to make it as difficult as possible for the arms race to begin again, as difficult as possible to reuse those components ever again in nuclear weapons.
Within 72 hours after arrival at PANTEX, each weapon is subjected to a series of safety and security inspections before the approved disassembly procedure can be started. The disassembly of nuclear weapons is a very exacting procedure and is conducted in a controlled environment under strict supervision. The time required to disassemble a weapon ranges from 5 days to 3 weeks, depending on the type of weapon.
This was my family in 1942. This was the year that PANTEX basically originated. And this was my great uncle, and he was running PANTEX, and this was my mother, and she was the chief bomb inspector. And they had marvelous times, and Mommy got to go on later on to be an anchor inspector. This is my daughter,
and this was her favorite toy. It was an old 1930s dynamite exploder, and she just loved it, and we couldn't get it away from her. She loved it. In Botswana, I took my daughters, and we went all through Botswana, and they were able to stand on dead elephants, and they thought that was very funny.
I am a member of Amarillo Zoo Friends. I'm on the executive board there. We're trying to raise money to improve the Amarillo Zoo. A lot of my affiliations are mainly outside of Amarillo. I'm a member of World Wildlife Federation, the Nature Conservancy with Texas, SPCA. I'm trying to think of all. Anything that has to do with animals or the environment, I've probably given money to at one time or another.
I was recently in Paraguay and stayed at a Nazi baby factory. I was one of the unadoptables here. And it was the old dictator of Paraguay's mistress home. And there were babies everywhere. I mean, 50 babies constant. And we found this in a swamp. And no one knows to this day what it is, because it looks like a huge Cape buffalo, but it's much bigger than they ever dreamed. I mean, this is Roland Ward Deluxe. And I took my own monk's outfits, and I told all of the people down in Paraguay that I was from Monk Substitute International, and that whenever a monk was sick, I would always go and anywhere in the world and substitute for them. And I was able to bless little Indian children, and it was a lovely feeling to help these impoverished people.
Went to college at Baylor University in Waco, Texas, not a Branch Davidian. And the reason why I went there is I wanted to get as far away from the Texas Panhandle as possible. And then I found myself upon graduation with a job at the Amarillo Globe News because I wanted to come back to the Texas Panhandle.
Sometimes I go to Scotland and search wonderful, wonderful museums out. And this was the Pencil Museum in Scotland. And this is pencils through the ages. And it taught you how they put lead inside of the pencils and things you'd always wanted to know. And from there, I went to the Stuffed Kitty Museum. And the Stuffed Kitty Museum had many freaks of nature in there that had been stuffed and then dressed in little Victorian garb. And it's probably one of the loveliest museums in the entire world. I hate the Louvre, I hate the Metropolitan, but Potter's Museum of Curiosity is the ultimate.
I was starting to get into environmental reporting and wanting to learn more about the environmental arena. And so I heard of a job at PANTEX. They were looking for someone in environmental public information. And I thought, what better way to learn about the environment than be in a place that actually has to follow the rules and regulations and that type of thing. So I tried out at PANTEX, and I didn't think I had a chance. And then they called me back, and I was there before I knew it. This is PANTEX's Earth Day booth, and we're participating in an Earth Day celebration. There are a lot of environmental groups out here from Amarillo and surrounding area. We have, I think, the Peace Farms out here, Star, Stand. This is the second year that PANTEX has participated in Earth Day. Last year we participated, it was geared for children, we had recycled paper and made bird feeders out of pine cones and birdseed. We have several other community involvement programs, such as our educational programs. We have a lot of people who work as tutors and mentors that go out to the different schools and help them learn how to read better. And Vanessa Tatum is in charge of that program, and she knows a lot more about it than I do.
For insights 1 through toil and tears, we thank the keeper of the years.
I am Vanessa Tatum, and I work as the educational outreach coordinator for PANTEX Plant. we are directly involved with the community, you know, externally, internally. And you always feel like you're making an impact. You always feel like you're a big picture because you deal so often with the public, public interest, public attitudes. And that's a big responsibility.
The Amarillo Economic Development Corporation is funded off the House since sales tax. As far as what I do with PANTEX, I help generate support as far as, like I said, like learning more about PANTEX. Whenever there is a hearing, I help generate support as far as getting actual community individuals, whether it's members of the chamber, business owners, or just people who are interested in supporting PANTEX, encourage them to come and attend the hearing, to give public testimony or written testimony, and I provide them information on the actual, what the hearing's about, what the issues are, and if they need help in developing their testimony, I also help with that. But it's their testimony, but I just give them the information to help them formulate their opinion, not actually their opinion, but to help them formulate their knowledge about the issue so they can form their own opinion and present their testimony. Because that's the whole issue behind the hearings, that the Department of Energy wants the public's input.
I think the most pressing image about PANTEX for me is death. And as a Catholic priest, death is something that I deal with a lot, and it's an important part of the human journey, because death is a part of life, and only until we admit that there's death can we really come into the fullness of life. I think PANTEX, for us who live here in the Llano Estacado on the Southern High Plains, is about death. The people who work there are good people, there's no doubt about that. But the work is causing death, and until we can admit the death that's going on, we're not going to come into life. Plutonium, environmental dangers, people's health, it's all part of that death. But I think the death goes back even further.
I collect different manuscripts from all the way back to the 1500s of different infamous people. And here I have Charles Manson's fingerprints from Folsom Prison. And this is written by David Berkowitz. I'm the son of Sam, and I killed six people in 1978. And I made this frame myself and inlaid it with 44 special shells. This is Pope John the 23rd on vacation. He has his riding crop and has hate and love tattooed in Latin on his knuckles, and his little holiday hat when he's out on a romp. And just looks like he's having a wonderful time.
I think PANTEX really does put us in the context of the end times. That kind of attitude has led to a lot of death, a lot of dying, and some of the outgrowth of that, I think, for us has been the Dust Bowl, the Great Depression, and other parts of our history over the last 100 years. So I think now this is another chapter of our history. PANTEX is about a certain death that's taken place, and it's connected to the bigger death of our wartime industry, and it's a death that we have to admit if we're going to really deal with this issue and the long-term consequences of it.
We've been asked to give my opinion about PANTEX today. If it's needed, I'm with it 100%. But I sure think we need to ask the question, is what we're planning on doing needed? In other words, I think it's time we quit discussing it after having three different scope meetings over 3 years and still don't have a positive plan. I think it's high time that somebody got together and have. I attended one of the meetings when they had the Safety Advisory Board. In fact, it's the only time I've ever made a talk at one. And I expressed my opinion then about they certainly weren't safe then. In other words, I saw the smoke and I heard the sound when they blew up radioactive material out in the open. And I saw some records the other day where they have records showing that there had been an increase of cancer. I had cancer myself, but I don't think that the odds are too great to say that because I lived here about 15 years on the plant, I don't say that that's what caused it.
All these pens are people who have either died of cancer or who now have cancer living out from the plant and around the plant. All these have lived here at one time. Some may have died elsewhere. But here right here's the city of Panhandle, White Deer over here. But you'll notice that all these plant pens kind of fan out from Pantex. I don't know that Pantex was the cause of any of these cancers, but I sure would like to them prove that they weren't.
There were what, five farmers that were watering out of wastewater from the Pantex plant that went across to the old lake over here. And there were, what, five of them died with cancer?
Mm-hmm.
And another one is in real bad shape with cancer now. And they
lymphoma type.
Used it for irrigation water on land between the Pantex plant and the Pantex lake over here. And I was concerned about that. There's one of the pens.
Well, of the 16,000 acres that we maintain control of, we lease back to Texas Tech about 6,000 acres. They use that land for research on crops and on livestock. And so we feel like we're doing our part for not only research for high explosives that we do out here, but also we kind of do our part for crops and research in the livestock area as well.
The people that work at Pantex all wear really ugly clothes. They're the kind of people that roll their blue jeans up like this and think it makes it look like a formal suit, and the kind of people that buy their suits at Sears. Double pleat people, church-going people, God-fearing people. The kind of people that if you're going to get on a bus between here and Tucumcari and there's an enormous woman and she's sweating under her armpits like that, just beads of sweat are coming out of her armpits, and she's holding a gunny sack and the gunny sack is full of chickens. And the chickens are going, look, 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 and it smells bad and the air conditioning's broken and the chickens are shitting all over the place. And right across this thing is a nice kind of well-dressed, regular-sized, regular-coffered, regular-dressed Pantex employee. You'd always sit next to the fat woman and the chickens rather than be anything to do with the Pantex people. They're the kind of people that don't belong and should not be in the Texas Panhandle. They're the kind of people that if anybody in the world from Robin Hood on down were recruiting highwaymen, they would always be chosen last. They're rotten and dirty people. They're nest featherers, and we don't want them here. They're worse than Wittenberg. Almost.
I had a concern about safety at Pantex, when I first met Carrie, because I hadn't been involved with Pantex before. I knew it was out there, but I didn't really understand what was going on, and DOE certainly wasn't telling anybody at that time because we still had an enemy that we were pointing nuclear weapons at. When I first met Carrie, I had a big concern about the chemicals that were being disposed of out there. Whether it be tritium, plutonium, or just the regular industrial waste, and had a lot of perceived fears about the safety and security of PANTEX and what they were doing out there. The more that I've become involved in going to the meetings and learning about tritium and plutonium and the industrial waste, I realized that that PANTEX plant is probably a hell of a lot cleaner than some of the other industry that we have in Amarillo. Just because it is run by DOE, and DOE realizes that they're probably going to have to clean it up if they mess it up, which, you know, they're planning on doing with, well, with their current
plus laws. You're a government entity, so you're under so many more rules and regulations than you are the private sector.
All day long on the prairie I ride, not even a dog rock by my side. My fires I kindle with chips gathered round. My coffee I boil without being brown. I wash in a pool, dry on a side.
We have a water aquifer under the panhandle running from Texas all the way up to Nebraska, really covering most of the Great Plains. And our crops, our cattle, all of agriculture is based upon this aquifer.
The sky's my ceiling, my floor is the grass. My music's a lowing of herds as they pass. My books are the stream, my sermon's a stone. My parson's a wood on his pulpit of bone.
And there's a perched aquifer that is 100 feet or a couple hundred feet above the Lala. And they have discovered contaminants in the perched aquifer that have already seeped down to the perched aquifer. And if you consider the same rate of seepage going on down the Ogallala, then it's certainly not unrealistic that that contaminants from PANTEX could seep down into the water.
Consistence to pride. My sermon, small thing I should not despise. My parson remarks from his pulpit of bone.
When you talk about the safety issues of PANTEX, I think you can say that we have been a relatively clean site over the history of the plant. Though you have to remember that the role that we play in the nuclear weapons complex is different than any other facility in the entire complex. We are primarily responsible for assembling and disassembling nuclear weapons, which means no processing happens at the PANTEX plant other than high explosives that we are responsible for. But we don't deal with plutonium or tritium or uranium or any of that in any form other than its component form with a hermetically sealed, non-radioactive seal coat around it. So when you talk about the safety concerns at PANTEX, certainly we have some, and we're always trying to continually upgrade our safety measures here at the plant. But if you take a look historically over our safety record, I think anybody would say that that we are most definitely the cleanest site in the nuclear weapons complex, and also in probably any other industry that you talk about in the nation.
I currently hold an office with the City of Amarillo as a City Commissioner. I'm City Commissioner Place 1. My first election was back in 1992, and I ran against a gentleman who didn't have any real problems or anything. I just decided that I wanted to be a City Commissioner, and I had to run against somebody. And a lot of people made issue as to, of course, why are you running against this guy versus that guy. I just decided to pick Commissioner Place 1. And ran, and this gentleman was the incumbent, and I beat him 58% to 42%, and so the campaign went very well, and I attribute a lot of that to the fact, well, number one, I worked hard, and I think that's what you've got to do if you're going to win an office. But number two, I worked at PANTEX, and I think a lot of people really liked the thought of someone who represents PANTEX they wanted them to represent their city because PANTEX is such a big part of the city of Amarillo.
I work closely with the mayor, city commission, and members of the Chamber of Commerce and other businesses in order to help in this program as far as public input, public knowledge about PANTEX. So really it's supposed to be your one-stop shopping basically to learn all you can about PANTEX.
You would have to go through the
That was what we first thought we were going to get at PANTEX, were the plutonium reprocessing operations from Denver. And it was kind of interesting because when the Chamber of Commerce and the boosters here in Amarillo, when they tried to really recruit DOE to bring the reprocessing facilities, one of their big calling cards is they said, well, we understand that it's really dangerous and shouldn't be close to a large metropolitan area, so what we have to offer here in the Texas Panhandle is a sparse population. And downwind from the plant, you only find a few farmers.
I think that all the city leaders here who are trying to bring all this wretched refuse, you know, into our area should all put their names on a plaque. Obviously, they're proud of themselves, and I think there should be a big cement monument out somewhere where we can, you know, the people responsible for all this great progress should put their names on there, and in 50 years those names will still be there and we can know whether they were right or wrong and whether their grandchildren should be proud of them or whether their grandchildren were poisoned by their grandfathers.
I wasn't in on any of that because I've already said that I was told to be at a couple of meetings. It was very early, 30 days before they took the farmers off. But I've changed my opinion a little bit on what is going on here. In other words, I think someone, citizen, politician, and someone ought to ask the question, why? Why is it needed before they proceed any further?
We have built up a kind of a world that's sustained on cheap and abundant natural resources that are becoming very constricted, and they're not going to be just flowing like they were before, albeit water or fertile land and oil and gas. So in that way, I think, you know, our round with death is just coming into view now. And in fact, I think that's the great transition between this century and the next century. And the quality of life that we'll have in the future will depend upon how we begin to deal with the death.
I've hunted quite a few spots around the world. These three I took in Zambia. This little grosbok was third or fourth largest ever shot in the world. He was coming toward me and could have taken a big stab at my ankles if he would have gotten that close. I hit him with 460. Now, I shot this sheep in the high Altai in Mongolia, and he was a very, very old ram and had no teeth left and probably would have starved to death that winter because he wasn't able to eat anything. And I would always take my guides and we would wear big hairy pig masks, and we were able to get fairly close to him wearing these pig masks. I shot these in Botswana, and he was very large. He was in the top 15 shot, and he was coming toward me, and it was the perfect way, if you're going to shoot a lion, to have it charging you and hitting him in the chest. And I had him made so that he's getting this warthog, and they wait behind a warthog hole and they put their paws up and break the warthog's neck and just crack it right there. And that's how they do a lot of their hunting for warthogs.
I don't remember exactly when I learned about PANTEX. It's sometime I don't know, maybe elementary school or junior high. And I still didn't know really what it was. All I knew was that if we had a nuclear war, that Amarillo would probably get nuked because of PANTEX. And so the running joke at our house was that if we had a nuclear war, everyone in Perryton was going to drive towards Amarillo so we didn't all get radiation sickness.
And it's my opinion we just can't wait for a little bit of nuclear shelling between North and South Korea, and then all the people having their skin flake off and their fingernails fall out and vomit their stomach guts out and all of that, that we're all just really hoping for it. Like everybody's hoping that Los Angeles could have a 12 on the Richter scale today. It'll make great television.
I believe all of you saw Project Stage Right video, is that correct? Okay, you saw in that video how we load and unload magazines with this particular piece of equipment here. Something that has not been detailed in the video is that we also do inventory automatically, and that's what we have set up, and we're going to show you a practice inventory run. And if there's not any additional questions, we'll go ahead and show you how we would normally do a inventory in this particular magazine.
Recent arms reduction treaties have had a significant effect on PANTEX plants. We no longer produce nuclear weapons here. Our mission now emphasizes an increase in our dismantlement process. As a result, PANTEX is now the interim storage facility for plutonium. So, Mason and Hanger has initiated a specialized program that further protects employees, the public, and the environment. We call it Stage Right. It was created to make sure that plutonium is safely handled and stored at PANTEX plant. You're about to see how Stage Right works. Some of the terms we use may be unfamiliar to you. For example, a term you'll hear a lot is pit. A pit is made of a solid metal plutonium inner shell, which is encased in stainless steel. It's the plutonium core of a nuclear weapon. We place the pits in special containers before we provide interim storage in the magazines. That's another word you'll hear a lot. A magazine is a structure where we stage or store pits.
I'm all for the PANTEX expansion. It's a good thing that's coming around Amarillo finally. Some people might not like it, but the more business that comes to Amarillo, it's better for Amarillo.
Are you talking about the expansion or the new lab thing that they're wanting to do? Is it the new lab?
Either one.
I don't know much about the expansion, but I know the lab would be great. Isn't it something where they're talking about? What are they doing with the lab?
Plutonium storage. And there's question. It's questionable about the plutonium storage. You know, there's never going to be a safe place for it. And I don't know if Amarillo is a place for it or not. I'd say Nevada, but the more jobs that come to Amarillo, it's great for me. I'm building homes, and the more business we get this away, it'd be better for us.
If we just could have a good east-west atomic war right now, like between Canada and Poland or something like that, the prevailing winds would kill just everyone in the northern hemisphere.
that might wake up the people in the southern hemisphere so that they could ban atomic weapons. The problem is, if they're getting so easy to make and so easy to deliver, you can probably get Microsoft to do it, probably be able to order them from Federal Express, that right away we're going to have some kind of a north-south war from North Korea to Nigeria or something like that. And that will kill all of us, and that will kill not just Homo sapiens, but if you understand the theory of evolution, it will kill intelligent life on Earth. Because at that certain moment when life began to evolve, we're the ones that began to evolve with intelligence, just like rabbits began to evolve with long ears or praying mantis with long feelers. And most people think that no other intelligent life on Earth would ever come along. That means we can never have another Jurassic Park. It would be really sad.
Last night we had the strangest dream we'd ever dreamed before. We dreamed that men had all agreed to put an end to war.
I think there are two principal reasons that I feel civil disobedience or holy obedience, depending on how you look at it, kind of actions are so necessary. And I guess, first, my sense is that there's absolutely just something inherently right about resisting. And people are constantly asking, well, you know, do you believe you're having an effect?
From the very beginning of our activities here, we chose the dates of August 6th and August 9th, the anniversaries of the bombing in Hiroshima and Nagasaki, to focus on, because for us those mark a watershed in the way wars have been or can be conducted in the world. We feel like, although those weren't the largest bombings of civilian casualties, they were in a way the first intentional bombing of civilian targets rather than military targets as a way of intimidating the world. They were also, although directly an attempt to end World War II, clearly the first shots of the Cold War.
Oh, that was horrible!
Well, my opinion of PANTEX is that it is a very, very economic stimulus in the entire city in the panhandle of Texas, the city of Amarillo and panhandle of Texas. I am all for it simply because I don't think that it is a threat to our safety in this community, and it hires minorities, and that is a plus. I mean, I see people come from the community from whence I've come that have never been able to make a decent living until PANTEX came about, and we're very, very grateful for it. We hope that the DOE will keep it safe, and I'm hoping that it will continue to hire college graduates and take those people who could not afford to go to college and give them a start to grow and to develop a skill.
I don't feel any personal responsibility as far as the assembly or disassembly of the weapons, because that's not my job. I've never done it. I don't do it. I feel very confident in the people who do perform that work. The responsibility I feel as far as PANTEX goes is educating the public on the dangers of or not of what's going on at PANTEX. A lot of people are afraid of the unknown. They don't know what's going to happen. They're not really sure what plutonium is. We get people coming to us all the time telling us that plutonium is some type of green ooze that's coming up from the ground, and it's not that at all. It's a solid form. It's in a solid form. And our responsibility, I feel, as part of the External Affairs Department, is to educate people with regard to what plutonium is, how it affects them, how we're doing our jobs very safely, efficiently out there. So that's probably the only responsibility I feel as a PANTEX employee.
Like the first bird, praise for the sea.
Look back at war, and especially at nuclear war and nuclear bombings, and they will wonder, how could this possibly have happened? In the same way that we look back to 1865 and we say, how could there have been slavery 120 years ago? How could this have happened? Or we look back to 1945 and we say, how could we have allowed the Jews to be exterminated? You know, from the 1930s, the New York Times was reporting that it was going on, and people in our country weren't resisting. and people in Nazi Germany weren't filling the jails. And people are going to look back on nuclear weapons and war in the same way that we now look back on 50 years ago and say, how could this have happened? Why did people let this happen? Why did the Germans behave as good Germans and not fill the jails? And we feel that it's very necessary to resist, and we feel that when people look back, the people who were resisting are going to be the people who were seen as the realists and not the idealists.
I mean, there's nothing about this that makes sense. We live in a real world. We have real problems. We've got real people here that would like to address those real problems. But why in the world are we not listening to people that want to make things happen instead of the people that's trying to take us down to some path of total destruction? I can't understand it.
Well, I'm Don Well. I'm a science fiction writer. In my book, Uncle Ovid's Exercise Book, the figure of Pantex shows up two or three times. Uncle Ovid's is about metamorphosis, and of course the biggest metamorphosis we have today is that that's brought on by radiation, and growing up here in Amarillo, Pantex is the ultimate symbol for radiation. Well, I write around Amarillo because I think it's important, first off, to make mythology of where you live, to enchant the landscape. Amarillo, to a lot of people, seems very politically conservative and culturally conservative, but sometimes under those pressures, a lot of really interesting things blossom out, like Cadillac Ranch, like my writing, like some of the really colorful eccentrics you'll meet in Amarillo.
My life and your life is boring and humdrum. And we wake up every morning that just the same as it was yesterday. And it's only through art and invention that we reinvent ourselves every morning, that we look in the mirror, that we part our hair new, that we shine up our teeth, that we smile and we say, it's a new world, little man, I'm going to go out and have a great affair today. That's what art is. I'm building a system of unanticipated rewards. And that system of unanticipated rewards do not go in museums and are not to be seen by the public when they know they're seeing them. They're to come as surprises. The Cadillac Ranch is to come as a surprise to people who are hitchhiking or bicycling or driving across the country. I hate art that's in museums because the museum programs you to like it or not like it. Recently, a group of art rebels in Amarillo, who I have been in touch with, known as the Dynamite Museum, have been putting up signs. Signs on lonely roads, signs in front yards, signs on other people's property. The signs claim squatter rights, and the signs are crackpot. They mean nothing, they have no significance, and they are not important. And that's why they're the most important thing we have going for us in any kind of visual impact communication that you can get from a car. If you think about it, the only kind of art left that you're going to have a first impression of and not have to see a picture of it on television or in the museum is art that you see in time and space, and you have to be there and alive and moving at that time to see it. It's like a happening. And if you're driving in a car and you see a sign for the first time, that is like seeing something for real.
Out, friends, here's Leon. Take it away, boys. Take it away. Oh, everybody.
I've been in jail for a total of about 17 months so far, and I have five left to serve as soon as the Bureau of Prisons gets around to notifying me where I'm supposed to go. I was just in for 8 months, and I just got out last week.
What are we going to do with the plutonium in the pits long term? And I think until the government decides what they're going to do with the plutonium, what they're going to do with these pits, I think the safest place for this material is at Pantex. We have a great repertoire of safety, security, knowledge, and research already existing at Pantex. And why have that added security risk of shipping it somewhere else and having someone else do it that's not as well qualified as Mason Hanger is?
I probably got my politics from Will Rogers, and I grew up thinking that, and still think, that there are two issues, pretty much, are two sides to politics. One is money and one's people, and to the extent in any moment or any hour or any day or any week or any year, when money speaks louder than the voice of a person. Well, we're not in a democracy.
I really think that you have these extremes on the outside, but the community support for what goes on out there is going to be decided in the middle, and it's going to be decided in the mainstream.
I think PANTEX is a very good idea. It's a lot for Amarillo, a lot of work for Amarillo. I hate to see anything happen to that place, because Amarillo will go down in a hurry.
It's very good for the economy, too, because of the people it supports around here. It's very good, you know.
But that doesn't make any difference. What was the economic effect of Dachau on of the death camp on Dachau? I'm sure all their barbers were busy and their beauty parlors were busy too. It's an evil and wicked place, and it should be removed. And if you've got cancer and they cut it out, nobody says, what is going to be the effect of this hole in you? It means you're going to have a scar. And if we remove PANTEX, we'll have an economic scar. I happen to think the town will get over it, but I don't care. I like living here anyway. And if we don't get over it, it certainly is worth getting rid of PANTEX anyway.
PANTEX has been a very good place to work for me. You know, I've worked there for 4 years, and I've really enjoyed it. It's doing what I like to do, which is public relations, community relations, being involved in the community. And really, there's not another place in Amarillo that I can be so involved with the community as with the PANTEX plant, and it's offered me a lot.
My hobbies include just about everything. I've been accused of being involved in everything but water polo, and that's one sport that I have not decided to do.
I've always liked to collect rat traps from around the world, and this rat trap is very special to me. The little rat comes right in here, and he pops in, and there he goes, and he can't get to the breadstick, and so he has to climb up here, and there's another little latch that he can't get back down. And this is very ingenious. And you can fill this with water or battery acid, and when he walks onto this little platform, it opens this up and gets ready for the next rat. And it was made in West Germany in the late 20s, and I'm sure that the man who invented this was deep into Auschwitz and Buchenwald later on in life.
My real focus, or the new focus on my hobbies, has to do with my children these days. I've gone from my wife and I used to be very involved in a lot of civic organizations and a lot of civic programs like Miss Amarillo and the Amarillo Triathlon and all of my softball and football and racquetball.
This is my favorite elephant gun. It's a 460 Weatherby that I take to Botswana and Zambia, and it's always done me well. And it's a shell that it shoots, and when you're in the bush and you're in a pinch, it works for a good marital aid also.
And my new focus now is, number one, trying to get my new house in line, and I spend a lot of time doing that, but number two, just carting around my kids. And I've been told this many times, that it's going to be a rephasing in my life as soon as they start taking on their activities and their right. Because I'm now responsible for getting Philip to baseball practice and getting Shelby from ballet to gymnastics and all of that. So it's a new focus.
This is a Mannlicher, a Rhodesian sniper rifle. And a lot of the guys in Africa, there's a lot of gay big game hunters, and they all use Mannlichers.
But I continue to work on a lot of the things that I've always loved to do, such as flag football. Flag football has been a passion of mine over the last 8 to 10 years, and we've had a really good team, and I've coached that team over the last 8 years and done really well.
It was my 20th reunion in high school, and I took a 350-pound transvestite And it was a lovely evening. I kept tripping over his or her train.
Another one of my passions is songwriting and singing, and so I've been involved in music one way or another ever since I was a kid. I was in the musical drama Texas for several years when I graduated from high school, and in all the theater productions at WT, and so I continue to try to do that as much as I can with the Big Texan Opry and singing at church. And several years ago I cut an album called Knock Knock, which was a lot of my original country songs. So I continue to try to do that, but more than anything right now, I'm focused on kids.
Good evening, and welcome to the world-famous Big Texan Steak Ranch, home of the 72-ounce steak and tonight's Big Texan Opry. Sit back and enjoy an evening of country's best talent from the Texas Panhandle and beyond. And now please give a big Texas-sized welcome to your host for the evening, the wonderful and talented Kevin Knapp.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. How are y'all tonight? I hope you like a little George Strait, because I'm going to do a little number for you called Amarillo of a Morning. It's one of my favorite songs. I hope you enjoy it.
Everything that I got is just what I got on.
Of course, I'm totally supportive of PANTEX. It's been here since the Second World War. It's probably one of the key facilities for the United States to start addressing its concern about what we're going to do in energy for the future. It's a great place to be.
My saddle in Houston broke my leg in Santa Fe. Lost my wife and a girlfriend somewhere.
It's a poor idea to keep plutonium in usable form. The pits are in usable form. And so it would be a big mistake to store them here permanently, because you encourage people to come here and to target Amarillo as a opportunity for terrorists or for rogue countries, as an opportunity for them to capture some bomb capability, and it just doesn't make sense.
One of the weapons that is currently in dismantlement is the B-57. B-57 was produced at PANTEX as a new weapon and now is coming back for dismantlement.
What I've got is mine. I ain't rich, but Lord, I'm free. Amarillo by morning, Amarillo's where I'll be.
Probably we're going to have all kinds of horrible wars and wonderful mutations, and the freak shows are going to get great, because North Korea will have a war with Pakistan or something like that. And in my lifetime, we're going to have three-headed babies that can play basketball when you go to the circus. I mean, we're really going to have some first-class freaks again.
This is Brenda, she's my psychic decorator. I use this on my Christmas tree, and it's a shrunken head that I've put on a little porcelain Christmas tree angel. These are human knuckle bones from Tibet that take the place of popcorn on the Christmas tree. This is my human chin bone sun visor from Borneo.
Soccer and basketball and karate and gymnastics and, like I say, anything else that they can be involved in. And so those are Kevin Knapp's hobbies right now. Probably tomorrow they will all change, and I'll probably decide to do water polo.
Well, I hope as the DOE approaches this problem that they're going to find that the best approach is going to be to get rid of these pits, change them into some kind of a form that people can't readily access for weapons, and put them underground, put them in a location where they aren't harmful to the environment or to people.
What I know about plutonium is I think it's the most deadly substance in the world, but I really don't know whether plutonium is a gas or a liquid or a metal. I know that it could spread very quickly if there's the wrong kind of explosion in the form of dust. And I know that the wind blows like hell here in the Texas Panhandle. And you can go right down there about 10 miles and see where they're doing all these experiments with windmills to make electricity. And the reason why is because the wind blows like hell across the Texas Panhandle. And that's the way plutonium is spread, by the wind. So when they have their accident, and they will, because that's what Murphy's Law says, they'll be able to kill a whole lot of people before the wind stops blowing.